So we're going to talk about authority tonight. This is something that I've never heard in church. The church doesn't want you to know how to have authority. But guys, if we don't know how to have authority, we're not going to go to the next level. So this is really important to know about authority. The things that God's been teaching me this week. Okay, what is a Girgashite? We've talked about Girgashites. We talked about the seven heads of the dragon. And the Girgashite is part of the foundation of the seven evil spirits. The Girgashites on one side and the Canaanites are on the other side. So the Girgashites are the teaching and the law. And on the other side, the Canaanites are the pastor. And the spirit of service replaces the spirit of Canaanite. And the spirit of teaching replaces the spirit of Girgashite. Now we've talked, there's a couple of people that are new, but we've talked about what Girgashites are in our world, because that's in the Bible. And people talk sometimes, they're like, well, what does the Bible have anything to do with my life right now? Everything. I was so thrilled because people are starting to realize that things that happen in your life are speaking to you. That's God actually, you know, when something weird is happening, like for instance, their wife lost their phone. And that's kind of a type and shadow of they've lost connection. You see what I'm saying? And they keep losing their phone. And so when something happens over and over and over again, that is a pattern. That is repetition. God's trying to talk to you. So in the previous messages I've had, I have been shown what a Girgashite is by something in the natural. And a Girgashite is like an acorn with a shell. Okay? And what's inside of that shell is the seed, and it has all the life it'll ever, ever need. It has all the food it'll ever need. But the problem is, it remains alone. John 12:24-25 says, unless a seed falls to the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it falls to the ground and dies, then it produces much fruit. The problem with the church today is that we're not producing fruit. I don't know of anybody that can produce fruit. Producing fruit means that you actually have the ability to produce fruit in the midst of a famine. Isaac sowed in a famine and he reaped 100-fold. That's called producing fruit. When no one else around you can produce fruit, you're going to be able to produce fruit. I don't see that in the church. There's going to be, maybe. But the point is that the reason why is because the church doesn't teach death. The church does not teach that we have to die and fall to the ground just like Jesus did in order to produce fruit. They say that Jesus did everything for us and we don't have to do another thing. But see, that's going to be where you're going to depend on Jesus's fruit and you'll never produce your own fruit. You see the difference? That's why we're ineffective as a nation. We're supposed to be a nation. All Christians and all churches around the world are supposed to be a nation. And that nation is completely ineffective compared to the rest of the world that's just dominating us. Would you say? Amen. Reason why is because we take the gospel of salvation out there to them, where we are still dark inside and we don't have full light. And we take it out there, and it's totally ineffective. The church teaches that we're not supposed to come into perfection until we get to heaven, whatever that means. Heaven's supposed to come here. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So the sons are going to actually stand on earth and pull heaven to earth. So we're not going to heaven. Anyway, the point is that comes from an Egyptian teaching that the Egyptians taught that you are not perfected until you actually die. But guys, if you wait till that, it's too late. We're supposed to be perfect on this earth, which the Bible says perfect is somebody who has overcome their soul. Their soul does not drive them anymore. So we are to reach perfection on this earth, or we're never going to be able to drive out the enemy out of our land. And that's how you produce fruit. Okay? So what a Girgashite is when going back to that seed, the Girgashite is that shell that that seed has around it. Okay? There is one purpose of that shell, and it is to get that seed into the ground, to protect it until it gets into the ground. Once it's done that and it's in the ground, what happens to that shell? In a natural realm, what happens? The water comes on it, and then it decays and goes into the ground and dies, doesn't it? Guys, that's the type and shadow of the law, of every law. So a Girgashite, as I understand it now, God's showing me more and more and more, the Girgashite is the law. Everything that covers, everything that protects, everything that holds things together is a Girgashite. A type and shadow of a Girgashite is a parent. Because we have a child, and that child needs to be fed, it needs to be clothed, and it needs to be provided for, cared for, protected, right? We don't just have a child and let it just, you know, fend for itself, right? So a parent is a Girgashite. But the problem is that child needs to grow up and learn to get their provision from God. But we as parents in this nation are still holding on to our kids and not letting them go out. We want to hold on and provide for them, and you're doing your kids a great disservice. Not only that, we teach them about welfare and food stamps and all this other stuff. And so what are they doing? They're sucking on the government, which is another Girgashite. America is a Girgashite for the whole world because it's our money system that is in the top place. Guys, that Girgashite is coming off. I'm going to show you type and shadow that the Girgashite's coming off. But I want to show you this. God told me this week to go watch 2012 again. And I sat there watching it, and you know, you get caught up in the destruction of it all. But I saw, as I always do, principles. And the one principle that hit me was authority. I don't know if you noticed, but when the main actor of the movie, he went to take his kids to the camping ground, and when he did, there was a fence that was there, and it was preventing him from being able to take them to the camping ground. So he had a choice: let the fence keep him back, or he took his daughter's hat and he threw it over the fence. He said, look at there, we got to go get it. The thing is that guy, he had a destiny that was going to save a million souls, somewhere around a million souls, okay? So if he didn't climb the fence and go find out what in the world was going on, he wouldn't have been able to fulfill his destiny. So he actually overcame the law. Because what was happening in this movie was the government knew for 2 years that the world was going to be destroyed, but there was an information blackout. They were keeping the information hidden, which is a Girgashite. None of the people down here knew anything about anything. All of a sudden, when all hell breaks loose, the people are just caught up in a sea of souls, and they all die. Did you notice that in the movie? Nobody told them anything until the very last moment. That's the danger of not having any authority. The devil is going to make sure that his people have authority. And God is going to make sure that his people have authority. But in order to have authority with God, you have got to subdue your soul. Your soul cannot rule you. So what, and other things in the movie, is the main actor, as he proceeds to go over that fence, he finds out that the government has secluded that area because something's going on, you know, and that puts him on his path to where he needs to go for his destiny. Well, as he keeps going, the world's starting to be destroyed, and he's like 5 seconds ahead of it. It's just like boom, boom, boom. I mean, everything is just happening right behind him. One of the scenes that he's in the airport, and he's got all his crew, and they're fixing to get on an airplane, and they're just going to take the airplane. Think about it. The whole world's going to be destroyed. Now, see, it's against the law to steal, right? But is it against the law when the whole world's going to be destroyed and you're just trying to save your life? And you're hearing somebody tell you what to do, okay? So what happens is they're in the airport, and the fireman is sitting at the door, and they run out the door, and the fireman opens the door, and he says, "Hey, you come back here." And 5 seconds later, the whole building that the fireman was in is destroyed. So do I listen to him? Do I go, okay, well, I'm going to go back and get destroyed too? Or do I follow the voice that's telling me what to do? As you'll see in the movie, and then another thing that happens is they get on the plane, and the tower says, you don't have clearance to take off. You don't have authority. And they take off anyway, and 5 seconds later, the tower gets destroyed. See, authority is very, very important. And there are people that get on these boats that's the only people in the whole world that get saved are the ones that get on these arks. But the people that are on these arks are not necessarily God's people. Most of them are the devil's people. Because the devil has given them authority. He's given them money. Therefore, they were able to pay an astronomical price for a place on this boat. So I'm telling you right now, if you don't have authority, you're going to be one of those that dies in the sea of souls. So that's what this church is all about, if we call it a church. I'm here to train you how to overcome your soul so that you can be a son, so that you won't die with the sea of souls that don't know what in the world's going on and have an information blackout. What God has been talking to me about is the way the Bible works, guys, is a day is as 1,000 years, the Bible says. And there's about 6,000 years that have happened. The way God works is he lays out the 1,000 years, which is one epic, and then he lays out the second 1,000 years, and then it's on top of each other. And what happens is you start the same way, and the spiritual climate, the demons come in, and they start working on the people, and by the time you get to the end, there's a harvest. The plant that was growing is full grown by the time you get to the end, and you have to give an account whether you're going to be a wheat or a tare. Does that make sense? Okay, well, it grows this way as far as 1,000 years, but then it also grows this way. So think of it like this. The first 1,000 years, the seed was put in the ground. The second 1,000 years, it was watered. The third 1,000 years, it was cultivated or whatever. And it just kept going until we get to where we are today, where we're supposed to be producing fruit. That's why it's in my craw. I'm not sitting in some church that's going to hold me down and tell me I'm not supposed to produce fruit. That's blasphemy or whatever. Because it's in me. I got to be producing fruit. I know what my Father's telling me. They're going to drown in the sea of souls. So what God is telling me is that each level is one day. One day is as 1,000 years. So that's 6 days work. And then what happens on the seventh? We enter into rest, right? Which is going to be the millennium, which is the 1,000 years with the kingdom. Okay? So we are at the final stage. The spiritual climate is exactly the same place it was when Jesus came on the scene and started healing people. He went into the wilderness and he overcame the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, the lust of the eye, and then he came out and he had all authority to start healing people. But that's not hoogie boogie stuff. I'm going to show you how that works tonight. But it's the same spiritual climate. The tares are full grown and the wheat are supposed to be full grown. But what does that mean? It means the tares have full authority, and the wheat better have full authority. Do you see what I'm saying? But there's two seeds. There's the God's sons, and then there are the serpent's sons. Okay? And that's who's growing. Those are the two people that are going to have authority. The rest of the people are going to be destroyed. I mean, that's pretty much how it goes, guys. But both have authority from different fathers. I talked to you about the fact of the winter equinox, and God is just really confirming that, because in Revelation 12, verse 1, it says, the woman was clothed with the sun. That is a full moon lunar eclipse. And it happened on the winter equinox, December 21st, 2010, this past year. I believe with all my heart, God is totally confirming it in me. That's when tribulation began. It began. It's time for harvest. So what happened right after that? 5,000 birds fall out of the sky. Fish are dead. All kinds of weird things are happening. Earthquakes. The moon caused, you know, the moon has something to do with the flooding and the earthquakes and the earth's core and all that stuff. And sins. The Bible says that the axis of the earth, it starts wobbling because it has so much blood on it. So much sin. It's what I'm trying to tell you about the end time. It's time for the harvest to get this sin off of us. It's time to bring righteousness. So I believe that the woman was clothed with the sun, and that's when tribulation began. And there's 3.5 years of tribulation, and then there's 3.5 years of the great tribulation, which is really going to be the bad time. But tribulation, I believe, is where God starts taking the Girgashite shell off. Now follow me, guys. Remember I told you about the parent. The parent is supposed to provide for that kid until the date set by the father. Remember I told you about that verse, those verses in Galatians 4. It's like Batman. Batman's parents, he had all kinds of wealth, but he was a little boy, right? And so Alfred comes along and agrees to be his guardian and his tutor until he grows up and is able to take on the responsibility of having all that wealth, right? So that's what happens, is the father has given the son everything, but we are under tutors and guardians until the date set by the father. Then he sends forth the son. That's not just Jesus, guys. That's us too. And I'm telling you that the time has come for the son to be sent forth. It's full grown. Okay? So a son's life is every single footstep is ordered by God. So every day I'm getting up and I'm just going about my business and I'm studying the word. And God just pouring information into me. And he's showing me in the Bible where we are. And I want to show you that. Because my life, and I'm hoping that your life, because that's what I'm here to do, is we're over here at first. And here's the plumb line. And our life has to come in line with the word of God. And when it does, then our every footstep is ordered. And our life will be the word of God. We will be going through the exact footsteps that all of the ones in the Bible went through. And I'm going to show you that. This is awesome stuff. But this is what God is saying to me right now, guys, where we are. It's time to go to Egypt. And Egypt is a type and shadow of the world. It's time to go to the church first, because Moses goes to Pharaoh and says, let my people go. And 3 plagues come upon the children of Israel too. And then the 7 plagues come upon the world. And I will be starting back in Exodus. I can't preach something until I'm walking through it. Because I can preach it, and I'm trying to preach it. I'm trying to understand it. But when I start walking in it, my eyes are this wide. I'm going, oh my God, this is exactly what the Bible says. Because I'm real freaked out about this week. There's a lot that he showed me. But your training is so important. If anybody is not clean and pure and holy in their soul, that's the time right now that you need to be working on that soul. You need to be getting that junk out of your soul, because you cannot go to Egypt until it is. Because what happens before you go to Egypt is the Girgashite comes off of you first. Because when you get the Girgashite off of you, then you can start pulling the Girgashite off of the church. And then you can pull the Girgashite off of the world. Because remember, the Girgashite comes to cover. And remember, Isaiah 45:7 says, I, the Lord, create evil, chaos, calamity, and darkness. And these spirits have a purpose. The Girgashite has a purpose. If the Girgashite wasn't there, guys, we'd have chaos. Absolute chaos. And he has to have something to protect his sons until they grow up. Remember Alfred? You have to have something to protect them. So that's why he allows the Girgashite. That's why he created the Girgashite. Every spirit has a purpose. Okay? So what I'm trying to tell you is you cannot grow in authority, though, until you are not leaning on the government. You are not leaning on your parents. You are not leaning on anybody else to take care of you except your father. Except your father. You have to go out in the wilderness. If you want to know God, you have to say, Lord, I want to go out in the wilderness. And he's going to take you and put you out there, and you're going to be hungry. And you're going to be scared. You're going to be like, because see, you know that you can get your, self up and go get another job. But guys, it's getting where the Girgashite's coming off, and you can't just go and get another job. Jobs are getting scarce, and I'm going to explain that too. But with me, God was saying, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and then all these things will be added that you're seeking. So you can't allow anybody to be providing for you if you're going to go to Egypt. Okay? So don't even, you stay here. We will have a Girgashite shell, but it's a godly shell. Okay, for you to grow, because Moses led the children of Israel in the wilderness, and they were not full grown. They were growing as they went. Okay, Joshua was not full grown until, all that process happened. You will be provided for, but you won't be leaning on us. Because we are learning, the leadership of this church is learning how to let you face God yourself. We don't want you leaning on us. Our job is to grow you up, not have you sucking on us. So we're not going to stand in the place of God either. You're going to be responsible for your protection from God. You're going to have to face him yourself. And that's when you deal with all of your issues. So the leadership of this church is not going to shield you from God. You're going to face him yourself. In order to get provision, that's the only way it can happen. Okay? So I want to show you type and shadow of what happened when Moses finished his training and he was on his way to Egypt. Before he goes on his way to Egypt, there's one thing that has to happen. And then when he goes on his way and both of them are Girgashite, and I'm going to show that to you. But you will not have authority if you have Girgashite. The Lord says in Isaiah 51, it says, I alone am your comforter. So you're going to be provided for a little while, but God expects you to grow up. And then you have to say those words. He is alone my comforter, my provider, just like I was singing tonight. And then, to tell you the truth, the next step after going to Egypt, after on your way to Egypt, guys, I'm telling you right now, the taskmasters, the guardians, the tutors, the Girgashites are fixing to bear down on the souls, and they're going to cry out. But see, if you're not under them, then you'll be fine. Taxes are going to be raised, and this is going to happen quick. Taxes are going to be raised. I believe the Lord is showing me, I've seen a lot of people sick. I believe that the plagues and the sicknesses and stuff like that, that's going to increase because Girgashites have something to do with that too. But whatever it is, the people are going to cry out because that has to happen in order to want Moses to deliver you. If you're happy in Egypt, then you're not going to leave, right? So you're going to have to cry out. These people that are out there are going to have to come to the realization that they need a deliverer, or they're not going to leave Egypt. They're not going to want to come follow God and go into the promised land. So what I'm trying to tell you is step by step by step, we got to grow in authority. Go ahead. Exodus 4:18. And this is interesting to me is that I've actually lived this whole pattern in my life with authority. So I find it very interesting that I'm actually talking about it. God tells Moses, go to Egypt. And what he does is he asked his father-in-law if he can go to Egypt. God didn't say, Moses, go ask your father-in-law. He says, Moses, go to Egypt. So verse 18, then Moses departed and returned to Jethro, his father-in-law, and said to him, please let me go, that I may return to my brethren who are in Egypt and see if they are still alive. Jethro is a Girgashite. He is protecting Moses under his house. God said, go to Egypt. Don't ask anybody if you can go. So Jethro is a type and shadow of the law. We don't need the law's permission to do what God wants us to do. Okay? God told Moses to tell Jethro he was leaving, which again, like I said, is the type of law, and it's a Girgashite. He's a protector. Now in verse 24 through 26, it says, now it came about at the lodging place on the way that the Lord met Moses and sought to put him to death. And then Zipporah took a flint and cut off her son's foreskin and threw it at Moses' feet. And she said, you are indeed a bridegroom of blood to me. So God let him alone. At that time, she said, you're a bridegroom of blood because of the circumcision. What's interesting to me about this passage is Zipporah knew exactly what to do. God was going to kill Moses. God, are you schizophrenic or something? Didn't you just train me to go to Egypt and you told me go to Egypt and then I get my family and we're going our way on to Egypt and then all of a sudden you come against me like you're going to kill me? What is wrong with you? This is a type and shadow of what Jesus went through in the wilderness. You have got to overcome the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, the lust of the eye, in order to have authority to go out and set anybody free. So God knew that Moses had not taken care of something that he should have taken care of on the eighth day of his son, of his son's birth. And that was that he was commanded by God to circumcise his son. And he hadn't done it. And the reason why he hadn't done it was because Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, and Zipporah had kept him from it. Because you'll notice that it says, then Zipporah took a flint and cut off whose son's foreskin? Her. Does it say Moses' son? Does it say their son? No, because this child was an extension of her, and she didn't want to do something that was bloody. She didn't want to do something that was mean. You come against that with an anti-Canaanite. She's a Canaanite, because Canaanites don't like judgment. They don't like cutting. You're a bridegroom of blood to me because of the circumcision. But guys, if you don't put your children before God and let them be accountable to God, then they're never going to know your God like you know him. You've got to say, darling, I love you, but you got to stand before God with your own sins. And you got to sever it. And you do that by obeying God when he tells you to do something that's hard. I mean, I've had both of my kids are circumcised now. They are accountable to God now. Not to me. They don't come to me and say, Mommy, I want to know God. Uh-uh. God's going to them now because that line has been cut. What this is about, though, is the Girgashite. The circumcision is like a thing that's hiding, and so it has to be cut. It's another Girgashite. The cover is off. You see that? Okay. And it's interesting because it's his son. So this shows me type and shadow that the son is full grown, one with God, before he goes to Egypt, before we go out into the world, the church first, and we start proclaiming, let God's people go so that they can come and worship him, we are full grown. We are a full grown son. Okay? Go ahead. Now, if you are a soul, you're not going to make it, guys. You're not going to make it. Romans 13:1, look what it says. Let every, this is in the King James Version, because the New American Standard says let every one or every person. That's not correct. This is very distinctive. Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. For there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. All authority comes from God. All authority, even evil authority, comes from God. There's a purpose for it. Evil authority is to make you strong. I heard what happened to you, and I'm very proud of you, because when you are persecuted like that, and when you fight like that, you're building muscles. And see, you're in training right now to handle that, because God's going to do what he did with me, and he's going to sit you down with a pastor who has a title, a position, and authority, and he doesn't love you very much. He acts like he does, but he doesn't love you, and you're going to have to tell him, like Moses did to Pharaoh, let God's people go. And you won't be able to do that if you haven't been through some persecution and affliction and mocking and laughing, because you'll want to go home and cry, because he's gonna laugh at you. He's going to mock you. He's going to try to destroy you. So you've got to have people along your way that come against you, and you know where they're going to come from? I can show you in the Bible tonight. They're going to come from your own family. So all authority comes from God. There's the verse, Isaiah 45:7. The Lord creates all evil spirits, the seven heads of the dragon. Each one of them have a purpose. Okay, look what it says in John 19:9-11. Pilate said to Jesus when he was facing him, he said, "You don't speak to me?" He's trying to ask him, you know, who are you? Where'd you come from? Tell me what your authority is. Why do they call you the King of the Jews? He's got authority, apparently, right? But Pilate is the authority over Rome. You see that? This is an authority crash. Okay. So Pilate said to him, "You do not speak to me. Do you not know that I have authority to release you? And I have authority to crucify you." Jesus answered, "You would have no authority over me unless it had been given to you from above. For this reason, he who delivered me to you has the greater sin." And that was the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the church. So God gave Pilate authority to crucify Jesus because it was the fulfillment of the scriptures. If he didn't go through that, then we wouldn't be where we are today. The Girgashite purpose is to cover the souls until they're full grown. It gives you protection, okay? But when you raise up in authority, you no longer need the Girgashite covering. You then are able to, and see, you're never going to produce fruit if you have that covering and everything, okay? Once you remove the Girgashite covering, then you're able to produce fruit, multiply, subdue the earth, and fill it. And we talked about this several times, but it bears saying again. Produce fruit is para, and it means to grow, to increase, to make fruit. Multiply is rabah, and it means to grow in authority, enlarge. You're going to come against people. I had a lady come to me today. I worked till 3 o'clock today. I was dog tired. I'm not used to working, guys. I'm used to spending time with God. And now my business is coming back. And it's like, whoa, God, I don't want to do this again. I want to spend more time with you. But it's time to go out now. See? And this lady came in right behind me when I went to go get something to eat. And I was going to get a little nap before tonight because I was dog tired. And she came in and she insisted that I do her hair. I'd already turned somebody else down that called me on the phone. And she insisted that I do her hair because the first she used this, she used pity. She goes, "I got a party to go to tonight and I really need my hair done." And then I said, "No, I said, I can't do it. I'm really tired. You don't want me to do your hair. You really don't when I'm tired." no, I don't, I really want you to, now she got ugly, and she's, no, I really insist that you do it. And I thought to myself, I said, I have authority to say no. You're not going to bully me into doing something. You see how the spirit works? I have authority. She has authority. Who has the authority? I could say no. I decided to go ahead and do it. While she's sitting in my chair, she's pushed me a little further. She goes, I want my eyebrows done too. I said, no. She said, I need my eyebrows done. And I sat there and I went, okay. And God got me on it. God said to me, you failed that one. Because she was bullying me. You better be ready, guys. When you grow in authority, other authority is going to come at you. I chose to do her haircut, but I got bullied into doing her eyebrows, and I should have said no. Do you see how small? It's so tiny. But see, if I would have said no, I would have grown in authority. It's that quick. Things are happening. You have an instant conflict with somebody. And see, the world and the church tells you, oh, we'll just hold hands and sing kumbaya and everything will be all right. And you could still be a rapist and a murderer and I'll just love you. It doesn't work like that. You have to cut that rapist and that murderer. You have to say what you're doing is wrong. And they're not going to like that. So there's going to be conflict. And as you say it, then you rise in authority because you're obeying God rather than worrying about that person's feelings. Because that person is, what they're doing is destructive and it's going to destroy them. And if you don't say something, then you really don't love them. You see how authority works? Okay, so you're supposed to grow in authority. Now, the third thing is subdue the earth, and that word is kibosh, and it means to bring into bondage, to keep under. You're supposed to have the devil under your feet, not running around and destroying everything that you're trying to build. And then the last one is fill the earth, and that's male, and it means to consecrate. Live a life consecrated so that you can fulfill everything that God tells you to do. Go ahead. When you multiply, you begin to grow in authority, and then you can subdue the earth. And that is when the sons take possession of the promised land. We're not taking possession of the promised land if we don't have authority. See, the devil has authority right now. We've got to have a battle with him. Show him our authority and kick him out. That's how we take the land. There's no other way. We cannot just continue to say, oh, we'll just have peace. It's not going to work anymore. We've got to show up with the greater authority. But first, you have to overcome your soul. The soulish authorities are assigned to you are the tutors and the guardians and the Girgashites. And then the unrighteous world, and then the world. So when you overcome your soul, then you overcome your guardian and your tutor, and then you go out, you have authority to go out and pull down the unrighteous church. And when the church is cleaned up and they're fully the bride without spot, without wrinkle, then the church, the bride, goes to the world. That's how it works. Until you overcome your soul, then you have to obey the governing authorities, though. You are a soul. You cannot climb that fence. And you are going to have to die with the sea of people. Pharaoh, we've talked about it several times, was throwing the male babies into the Nile. And all the people had to throw their male babies into the Nile. But that was one of those babies was supposed to be the deliverer that was supposed to take them out of this slavery. But they were all souls, so they had to obey God. They were all souls until Amram and Jochebed, which were Moses' parents, were not souls. And so they did not throw Moses in the Nile. They put him in an ark and sent him down the river, and God had a plan because they were spirits. But if they were souls, then God gave that authority to Pharaoh, and they would have had to put Moses in the Nile. That's how it works. The sea of souls. So until you overcome your soul, then you have to obey the governing authorities, because all authority is from God. and only spirits rise above, but not all spirits are godly. Not all spirits. Like I told you, there's the serpent seed and there's God's sons, and both of them have authority and both of them have overcome the soul. Okay? Now I'm going to show you, we've talked about it before, but like I was telling you, that the layers of the thousand years, they sit right on top of each other. And the Bible is just as accurate, you can live your life by it, as they did 1,000 years ago, 2,000, all the way down. Because it's the same patterns in every one of the days, so to speak, the 6 days. So what that means is that's why the Bible says that man or woman, it's not talking about the ones in the Bible, it's saying spirit for man or woman is soul. When you see in the Bible woman, know that that story is about a soul. If it's not of God, if it's, it can also be used as the pastor teacher, because there are the fivefold, and the three male spirits of God is the apostle, prophet, evangelist. And the two female spirits are the pastor teacher. Do you notice that Noah's wife, her name is never mentioned in there? You know why? Because the spirit has subdued the soul. She is a woman that is under that authority, and she's either a pastor or a teacher type of spirit. And that's why her name is never mentioned. But other women like Jezebel that are mentioned in the Bible, you hear them because it's emphasizing the fact of what they are. Their name is mentioned. So it's just something to throw in. Go ahead. Exodus 1, 5 through 8. Joseph died and all his brothers and all that generation, but the sons of Israel were fruitful and increased greatly and multiplied and became exceedingly mighty, so that the land was filled with them. And now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. This is pulled from the fact that Joseph was the leader over, he was under Pharaoh and he was taking care of all the children of Israel, right? But Joseph dies. And what the people, when Joseph died, the people were numerous. They had multiplied. They were everywhere in Egypt, okay? But now a new king arose over Egypt. Now, I want to show you a little nugget I found when you look into the Hebrew. This is why I couldn't preach Exodus sufficiently until I was walking through it. Okay, it says they were fruitful. That word is parah. We talked about that, right? Be fruitful. They increased greatly. That's a new word. That's called sharats, and it means to bring forth, breed, okay? They multiplied. There's rabah. They grew in authority. They enlarged. They excelled. And they became exceedingly, and that's another new word. The word is mo'od, and it means to be diligently, exceedingly, far, fast, good, great, loud, louder. Possibly that's showing that the souls, because the soul talks. And when the soul talks, it just talks louder and louder and doesn't say anything. But the word mighty, when it's used up there, is the word asam. And that's also different. It's called break the bones. It means to be close, to be great, to be increased, to be more, to shut. So that the land was filled with them. Okay, and the word is male again. We had that one. So we've got, go ahead. We've got be fruitful, multiply, and fill. But where is subdue? Where is you need to have the devil under your feet? It's not there. The word subdue, remember, is kibosh, and it means force, keep, under, bring under bondage. It's not there. So therefore, it's telling us that the children of Israel, the reason why the new king arose was because they had not subdued the enemy. So, and have dominion is the word radah, and they didn't have that. Prevail against, reign, bear, make to rule, overtake. Guys, they had soul peace. Everybody was getting along just like it is right now. Oh, we just having a good old time because the soul's ruling, and we're just completely at peace, right? Revelation 6, 3 through 4. When he broke the second seal, I heard the second living creature say, come. And another, a red horse, went out. That's significant. He went out. He got out from under that Girgashite shell. Moses, go to Egypt. And so the Girgashite has to come out. The red horse, they have to leave in order to be able to go to Egypt. Matthew 10, 34 through 36. Do not think that I came to bring peace on the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. Those are the words of Jesus, guys. Ooey gooey, lovey dovey, Jesus. He came to bring a sword. And if he came to bring a sword, we need to bring a sword. Now he says, just like I was telling you earlier, for I came to set a man against his father and a daughter against her mother and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Oh, I got two out of three. And a man's enemies will be the members of his household. That's what Jesus came to do. You know why? Because some are going to rise up in authority and some are going to want to go blah, 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 blah. And be a soul. So there's going to be a sword. Go ahead. They did not subdue the Egyptians. They did not grow in their authority. Therefore, God allowed a new king to arise that did not recognize them. Exodus 1:9. The children of Israel are more, rab is the word, abundance, elder, enough, exceeding, and mightier than we are. That's what they said. This is what the when the new king arose, the Egyptians had a meeting, and they said that they are more abundant, they are exceeding and mightier than we are. And they said that they're mighty in number, atsum. They're mighty in number, okay? And they said, so come and let us deal wisely with them. And that word is shakam, and it means to teach wisdom, to make wise. But see, the devil's got worldly wisdom, and then God's got wisdom. And the only way you can get God's wisdom is to die, because you got to go out of the land of the living to get God's wisdom. So what they're doing here is they're going to reteach them our way, lest they multiply, it says, rabbah, lest they grow in authority, enlarge, and excel. That's what they did. They retaught them. And what has the church done to us? They have taught us that Jesus did everything for us and we don't have to do another thing and just sit here and wait until he comes and gets us. And I honestly think that the teaching of the rapture is a Girgashite. Think about that. Because I can show you later on. In the story of Joshua. And when a war comes, they will join our enemies. That word is yakaf. Add again, conceive, continue, exceed. And they will fight against us. The word is lakam, which means to devour, to eat, to overcome, to prevail. And they will leave the land. Look at what this is. Allah, arise, ascend, break the day. What did I tell you that happened? At the winter equinox. Remember I told you that was the first thing I heard. The Lord was saying to me, the sun is rising. And I didn't even know what that meant. But at the winter equinox, that's the longest night of the year. And after that night, the days start getting longer. So therefore, the sun is rising. God is symmetrical. When he says the day is breaking, arise, the morning, all that kind of stuff, he's going to have it in the physical realm too. So this makes sense that at the winter equinox, the sun is rising. And from the winter equinox until the summer equinox, it's going to be a time of judgment, guys. Because the sun represents judgment. Okay? So what happened was, and they leave the land. They didn't want them to have the power that judgment gives you when you are righteous and when you are holy. So they wanted to reteach them their ways. Okay? So they appointed, that word is sum, wise, appoint, commit, change, charge, consider, taskmasters. Taskmasters is the word mock, and it means discomfited, tribute, people pay tribute to, like taxes, forced labor, And they said taskmasters to afflict. That word is anah, and it means to abase, submit, and weaken. And the word taskmasters we had in Galatians 4, it's guardians and tutors. So their guardians and tutors started putting the clamp on them. Until the time set by the Father for the Son, which is Moses in this case, to be sent forth to be the deliverer. Guys, that time is now. That's what God is showing me. That time is now. Our steps are ordered. And God's saying that time is now. Tribulation has begun. This is where I got it from, Galatians 4, 1 through 6. Now I say, as long as the heir is a child, he does not differ at all from a slave, although he is the owner of everything. But he is under guardians and managers, taskmasters, until the date set by the Father. So also we, while we were children, while you're a soul, you're held in bondage by a Girgashite, under the elemental things of the world. But when the fullness of time came, the child is grown. You've grown over your soul. Your soul does not control you anymore. When the fullness of time came, God sent forth his Son. Born of a woman, that's of a soul, born under the law. Once your soul gets cleaned out of all that junk, now the man, which is your spirit, and the woman, which is your soul, can conceive the Son in you. And then the Son grows to full maturity, and then he's sent forth. That's how a son happens. A son is not just assumed because you said a little prayer of salvation. A son is wrought, like we had last week. He's wrought. He has to go through affliction. You have to go through the Son of Man process to be a son. A woman goes through so much pain to have a baby. And the same thing with you. You're going to go through the same thing. These are types and shadows and patterns to show you how God works. Now watch what it says. Born of a woman, born under the law, born under the Girgashite. Somebody's got to take care of that baby until it grows. Okay? So that he might redeem those who were under the law. So he is born under the law so that he might redeem those under the law. Give you type and shadow. The matrix. Jesus came into the matrix so that he could set the people free in the matrix. See, if he would have never come into the matrix, the people in the matrix would have remained slaves. See? So he came in under the law. And we do the same thing. We're born under the law. David, he was the son. He was the king, but he was under Saul. And even though Saul was the Antichrist, he was under Saul. So that's the same type and shadow. Paul says, I am a Pharisee of the Pharisees. Does that mean that when it applies to me, does that mean that I'm Hebrew or Jewish? No, that means that the sons are going to grow up in church. They're going to grow up in church, and they're going to be sitting there all their life going, this doesn't make any sense to me whatsoever. But yet, I was the Christian of all Christians. I mean, I sat there. I went to church. I was like, I want to know God. I want to know my Father. And so I was born under the law. Same thing. Okay, so that you can redeem those under the law. If you don't go into the strong man's house and fight the strong man, you can't get the people out. That we might receive the adoption as sons. So when you are born under the law and you lay your life down, just like the seed, just like Jesus, you lay your life down so that you can produce more fruit, then that's when you receive the adoption as sons. Because God is not going to call you son unless you lay your life down. You're not a son until you die. Because you are sons, though. Because, see, we're assuming that you're born of a woman, born under the law, that you might redeem those that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. Because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Therefore, If this is all the truth, if this is all the truth, you are no longer a slave, because we started out as a slave, although we were the owner of everything, but we go through this process under a Girgashite teaching of guardians and taskmasters to become a full-grown son. Therefore, you're no longer a slave. You've learned the Father's ways. You've learned whatever He wanted you to learn. The time set by the Father, it's time for you to be sent forth. You're no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. So the Christians, they claim that they say a little prayer and they get everything. But see, there's no death. If there's no death, there's no fruit that's going to be born. You're just sucking on Jesus's fruit, but you're called to bear fruit yourself. And that's not going to happen until you get holy and righteous and drive the spirits out of your soul so that you can have a clean hands and a pure heart. So, but if a son, then an heir through God, and this is why, because when you go in that ground, okay, there's the law right here, there's the fence, okay? I can't go over that fence. I don't want to be a part of that. So I have to die right there at that fence, at that law. And when I do, then I'm led by the Spirit. Then I'm, listen, hear what I'm saying, guys. Then you can say you're led by the Spirit. This is the way it works. Diplomatic immunity is when somebody comes from another country and they buy a piece of land. And they do not have to live under the laws of that nation, of the nation that they bought that land from. They're from another nation. Where are we from? Heaven. And we've been sent here to make this place like heaven. So therefore, when you die, you're not under the laws of this place anymore. Does that mean you can go out and kill somebody? No, it doesn't. You're under the law of love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. So if you love your neighbor as yourself, you can't kill him. But you have to die in order to be led by the Spirit. That is your government now. That is your father. You're being led by the Spirit, not by the law anymore. Okay? A son is a spirit-led angel, because an angel is not swayed over the pity or the bully or whatever of the souls. Okay? An angel is somebody who has overcome their soul and their spirit rules. Am I making any sense? All right, good. Go on. We were created, the Bible says in Hebrews 2, we were created a little lower than the angels. Remember, Adam was put in the garden to cultivate it. Adam was not given everything. He had to do the same thing we do, grow in a process. You don't hand the son, little baby son, everything. That's stupid. That's ludicrous. You have to grow in authority by the trials that you're called to face. Okay? Born of a woman, born under the law, but we were then transformed into the same image of God. And that happens as you get that word in you. Christ is formed in you. It becomes your DNA. Okay? And that happens in the fivefold, because there are seven evil spirits and there are seven spirits of God. And when you drive out the Amorite, then you replace that with the spirit of evangelism. When you drive out the Girgashite, you replace that with the spirit of teaching. When you drive out the Canaanite, that's the spirit of the pastor, spirit of service. Every one of the evil spirits has a spirit of God that you get in place of it. And when you take something that's dark and you start putting a little light in it, what happens? The rest of the darkness starts going, right? Okay. So we trade evil spirits for his spirits, and we get holy on this earth. If you don't, guys, you're not going to ever be effective in the kingdom of God. You will, you know, the purpose of you coming here is to learn how to do this. Matthew 5:48, therefore you are to be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Now we talk about in this world perfect. Well, I know what you did. You're not perfect. But see, God calls perfect when your soul doesn't rule you anymore. You're perfect. Sure, you're going to make mistakes still. But you still are considered by God to be perfect because you died to your soul. 1 Corinthians 13:9-12. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, does that say it won't come? Of course not. It says when the perfect comes. It's like a given. When you reach perfection, the partial will be done away with. The Girgashite. When I was a child, see this? I used to speak like a child. I used to think like a child. I used to reason like a child. But when I became a spirit, a man, I did away with childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, just as I also have been fully known. Christians say this is when we get to heaven. There's no heaven there talking about it. It's all about being perfect. And they say that you don't become perfect until you get to heaven. But guys, this is here. When the perfect comes, it's here. When you overcome your soul, you're not a child anymore. Go ahead. Philippians 1:6. For I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. That day of Christ Jesus is when the fullness is here, when the Father sends forth the Son. That's the day of Christ Jesus. The law cannot make you perfect. Going to church, that's what the Bible says. The actual Bible says the law cannot make you perfect. So don't think about Hebrew and Jew, Old Testament law. That's not what the law is. Why would Paul write a whole entire book of Romans about Hebrew law? Why don't we just cut the whole Old Testament out? Why do we need it? Because it's under the law. That's what the church says. It's so ludicrous. They're under the law because they need a mediator. But if you die, then you get face to face with the Father. You don't have a mediator anymore. I don't care if your mediator is Moses or your mediator is Jesus. If you're not coming to the Father to be trained, you're under the law. Okay, so the law cannot make you perfect. Going to church, regular church like what we have, it cannot make you perfect. It can't do it because they don't teach you. It's a Girgashite. They will not teach you what you need to know to grow to be a son. It's just set in place. That's why you got to go out. You won't stand before the Father in judgment. Like I said, Hebrews 7:19-20. For the law made nothing perfect. See? And on the other hand, there is a bringing in of a better hope through which we draw near to God. Now, I don't know if I did last week, but let me explain to you what God said about faith and hope. Faith is when you take a seed, and it's a good seed, and you've got good ground, and you take that seed and you plant it in that ground. And then you water it. Do you have a right to expect it to come up? Do you have a right to see a plant come up? Yes, because you planted something and you took the time to do it, right? But the church claims that they have faith, but they haven't died. There's no faith. There's no hope that it's going to come up if you haven't planted anything. And the church doesn't teach you that you have to die. So therefore, the law cannot make you perfect. James 3:1-2, for we all stumble in many ways. If anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man. If you have self-control and you're not led away by your soul, because what is inside of you is going to come out of your mouth when you're squeezed. So, and if he does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to bridle the whole body as well. If you can bridle your tongue, you can bridle knocking somebody out. self-control and the tongue. Those are two indicators of the soul. Now, does that mean that you never say anything bad? Of course not. But it means that when you do say something bad, you go, "Up, oh, I see that, I confess it, I want it out, Lord." And you fight the fight to get it out. Okay? But your tongue and your body is an indicator of where your soul is. Now, I want you to see that anger is an acceptable emotion. The zeal of the Lord came up in Jesus, and he threw the money changers out of his father's house. In John 2:17, his disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." Consume is like fire. See, I have zeal for the Lord. That's why I started this church. Because I was sitting in church going, "I just ain't getting fed, Lord." And when I'd spend time with him, I'd get so fed. And I was like, "I just don't see why I have to go back to that church. I don't understand." Because they're not doing it right. So now that we have this church, zeal for the Lord's house has consumed me. It makes me angry that they're teaching this garbage that you're never going to be perfect by. But now I know why. Because that's what God set in place until you grow up to be a spirit. In Ezekiel 5:13, "Thus my anger will be spent." Now this is God, guys. This is lovey-dovey God. Jesus, God, ooey-gooey. "Thus my anger will be spent, and I will satisfy my wrath on them, and I will be appeased. Then they will know that I, the Lord, have spoken in my zeal when I have spent my wrath upon them." Who is them? The ones that remain under the Girgashite comfort and protection. And they won't go out and receive from the Father. Then he pours out his wrath on those people. One of the faces of God, you know, you've got the lion, the eagle, the ox, and the man. That's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There's the four faces of God. It's the four cherubim. They've got all four faces, okay? One of the faces of God, and it also is about the type and shadow of the fivefold ministry too, so it all flows together. But one of the faces of God is an ox, and that's what's been rising up in me. And the ox is the authority. The ox, once you rise up in your spirit, you are not going to let a soul subdue you anymore. You're not going to shut up to some big fat mouth soul and bow down to it anymore. Because in the Bible, you know what bow down to is? Worship. If you bow, now you have to do that until you are a spirit. But if you bow as a spirit to another soul, you're worshiping them. So the ox, the bull, the face, this is the evangelist. It rises up in you and you start getting zeal and you start saying, "Lord, I want your name to be proclaimed in this city. I want your name to be proclaimed in this state, in this nation, in this world. I'm sick and tired of this putrid stuff that I'm having to walk in every day." And that is when you are going to take the Girgashite shell off of the church. Because you've taken it off of you. So you come to take the Girgashite shell off. That's what Moses did when he went to Egypt and he released the plagues. He said, "Let my people go." He was speaking for God. "Let my people go. And if you don't, then all the plagues come to do what? To take away all the comforts. So when I'm done, you're going to wish you had let my people go so you could keep your comforts." But that's not how it works. The world is going to be destroyed by the time the plagues are done. And that's what tribulation is all about. It's the same patterns all the way through the Bible. It's the same levels on top of each other. Every one of those levels experienced all of the seven seals. Because that's what determines whether or not you're going to have eternal life or not. Okay? This is the spirit of might, of power that will take down the evil and iniquity. And I want to show you how it does it, okay? As it bears the load. Let me explain that. When you go, when God sends you forth to the churches, it's going to be hard, guys. I already had my first encounter this past week. And I'm sitting there with the voice of the Lord. I know what God's told me. I know that this guy is taking the people of their church and he is using them for his money in his pocket, and he is not teaching them what they need to be to grow in the Lord. Okay? And God sent me to him to be a witness. My job was not to sit there and convince him that he was wrong, because that's not going to happen. I don't have a title. I don't have a position. I wasn't trained in seminary school. So who am I as far as he's concerned, right? But did Elijah, Elisha, Jeremiah, Jesus, did any of them have a seminary degree? In fact, they came against the church. All of them did. All of them came against the church. And this guy, he wanted me to be a part of pastors in the area. You know what that means? That was the Girgashite coming to cover me. I'll be daggum. So I sat there, and he didn't understand why I wouldn't be a part of his group. You meanie? I'm your brother. I don't understand. Aren't you born again? Well, I'm born again too, and you need a covering because you need somebody to be accountable to. I said, I'm not under the law. I'm accountable to the Holy Spirit, to my Father. Oh, no, you don't come to the Father. Jesus, you come to Jesus and the Holy Spirit. You don't come to the Father anymore. I'm like, our Father, which art in heaven? What? I mean, any of this ring a bell? So what I'm being told now is he laughed at me because he said to me, he says, I want to understand something. Are you calling yourself a pastor? I said, well, I don't really have a title, but I do have the spirit of service. So yes, I am a pastor. I have one of the fivefold as the pastor. And he sat down and tried to explain. He was like, no, there's an apostle. There's a prophet individually. I'm like, this guy don't get it. I could sit here and preach the entire Bible in context to this guy, but he don't want to hear anything I have to say because I don't have a title and a position. Under man. But I have the authority of the Lord. So when I left there, I've understood that he's laughing and he's mocking and whatever. Okay? Well, the ox rose up in me this week. And God said, declare an earthquake. Declare the sword to come against that church. Because that's what has to happen. It's just like Moses. When they came into the land, their job was to come up against the ones that had the authority in the land. The first one they came against was the Canaanite king. And they made a vow. And that vow was, I'm going to get up every day, and I'm going to put my hand to the plow until I drive out all of the evil pastors in the area. Because you cannot establish God's name and his lordship until you do. So God told me to declare an earthquake. What I say with my mouth, because I'm being afflicted and because I was sent by God, I could stay in these four walls and we could just have a great time. But then I wouldn't be obeying the Lord because he's the one who sends you out. That's what's going to happen. So the ox comes to bear the load. So I have to pray. I said, Lord, he can't see that he has a Girgashite and a Canaanite spirit that I could see immediately. He has all seven. God showed me all seven. And I tried to explain that to him. He goes, I said, let me see the Bible. I'll show you. He goes, no, I know the Bible. I'm like, okay. So the Lord showed me that he can't see. So I prayed for his veils to come off so that he could see. But if he does not make a choice to try to understand, if he wants to constantly not believe me and not look at his Bible and not allow the Lord to change his heart so that he can understand, then he's going down, guys. So here I am, an ox, and I come against his church, and I am banging it, saying, let my people go. Let them go. Or your church is going down. Let them go. Understand the truth and understand that what you're teaching is not the truth, or your church is going down. And I'm telling you guys, this is what's happening. When he falls, then when that king fell, then all the other pastors in the air, so to speak, are going to be scared because theirs is going to fall too. And then the true bride can come together. And then the true bride can go out to the world. But we cannot. Every church that's here is not the body of Christ. Because in those churches, there are evil spirits. And we cannot be one with all those churches like that. So what has to happen as an ox is I could run through that thing. But you have to bear the load. You have to pray for him to come out. You have to pray. You have to take... You have to fight demons that come against you, that try to cover you, and all this stuff that I've fought all week. I've had turmoil all week because of this. But I rose in authority. And see, that comes against you because you've got to rise in that authority. So the ox, it bears the load as it takes it down. The only way that you can take something down is if you go under it. And that's what you have to do. You have to go under it. And I am serving him as I pray for him to see. But he's not going to receive my witness. That's all I'm there to do is be a witness, be a truthful witness. I'm not there to convince you. Neither did Jesus. I'm going to skip that one for now. We'll come back to it later. Okay, go ahead. Mind control. This is what the soul does. Remember I told you there's the sons of God and then there's the serpent seed, okay? People that have authority in the serpent seed, what they do to you is they actually rise in authority when they have you under mind control. And when they have a soul tie with you. Because when somebody has a soul tie with you, they can take from you. And they are the ones that have possession of the high places. They use their authority to gain that possession of the high places. When you go watch your television, you're seeing the ones that have possession of the high places. Okay? But they're coming down. That's what the Girgashite is going to be coming down. Those, the ones that have the high places in the evil realm are the giants in the land. Okay, so I want to reteach you this. In Numbers 13, 27 through 29, we went into the land where you sent us, and it certainly does flow with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Nevertheless, the people who live in the land are strong. And the cities are fortified and very large. And moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. Amalek is living in the land of the Negev, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites are living in the hill country. See, the Hittites, the Jebusites, and the Amorites are the top three spirits. They're at the top, and they live in the hill country. They live in the high ground. The Canaanites are the sexual, deceiving, lying, anti-judgment, and they live by the sea. See that? By the Sea of Souls. And by the side of the Jordan. This is how a soul sees the serpent seed. They're so big and they're so scary. There's no way we could take them down. So Jesus, come and get us, please. But see, he says, go into the land that I gave you and possess it. But see, they didn't go up that mountain. They didn't face God and deal with all their sin so that they could see that they were given that land and they could take these guys down. You can't take evil spirits down if you have evil in you. Okay? So they had no authority because this is how they saw the enemy. Okay. This is what a spirit sees. Numbers 13, 33, 33. Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, "We should by all means go up and take possession of it, for we will surely overcome it." Interrupted by a soul that needs to shut up The men, look at that. These were spirits, but they were not spirits of God. They had authority, but they were already controlled by the evil spirits, so they couldn't drive the evil spirits out of the land. You see that? The men who had gone up with him said, "We are not able to go against the people, for they're too strong for us." See, Caleb and Joshua said, "We should by all means go up and take possession of it, for we will surely overcome it." But the soulish men, the ones that are, the evil men, the evil spirit men, they said, "We're not able to go up against the people. They're too strong for us." So they gave out to the sons of Israel a bad report. And I told you what I think that is. That's the rapture. That's why they believe in the rapture. That's why they've taught the rapture, because they can't conceive of taking the land, because they don't have the power to kick the enemy out of it. So they gave out to the sons of Israel a bad report of the land, which they spied out, saying, "The land through which we have gone in, spying it out, is a land that devours its inhabitants." They eat them. "And all the people whom we saw in it are men, spirit, of great size." There also we saw the Nephilim. Now we know what the Nephilim are. The sons of Anak are part of the Nephilim. "And we became like grasshoppers in our own sight, and so we were in their sight." That's what the soul sees. But Joshua sees, "We are able to take possession of it and surely overcome it." So what are you, a spirit or a soul? Because if you're a soul, you haven't driven out the seven spirits, you're not going to be able to overcome the evil spirits in the land. But if you are a spirit led by God, because you've already died, you have authority to take the land, guys. You've been sworn possession of the land. It's yours. But notice that God didn't just take his people into the land and say, "Okay, now you're here to take it, so all the people need to just leave or die. Won't you just die right in front of me?" Or notice that God didn't go in there and kill them all himself. They had to defeat the enemy. And you have to defeat all seven spirits in you first. And the way you do that is Jehovah Mekadishkum is the Lord who sanctifies you. And he comes to you every day. And he says, "Do this." And if you don't do it, you don't rise in authority. But if you do it, then you rise in authority. And then the tests get harder. And he says, "Do this." And you're like, "Oh, that's scary." But you don't want to be like Jonah, who fled from the presence of the Lord. Jonah couldn't do what God asked him to do in that presence. You can't abide in that presence if you have darkness and you want to keep it. You have to obey. And as you obey, you rise in authority. And then when it's time to take you into the land, which I believe is time, you're going to have the authority to drive them out of the world, because you've driven them out of you. You're going to have authority to drive them out of the church, and you're going to have authority to drive them out of the world. See how the Bible connects with our life? It's not just some old book. It is our life. It is how we do what God has called us to do. Go ahead, Tim. This is more souls, and they're complaining. Numbers 14:1-4. "Then all the congregation lifted up their voices and cried, 'I'm hungry, I'm thirsty, I'm hot. I don't want to do this. The prices are too high. Gas is going too high. I don't have a job. I don't have any food. Somebody take care of me. Oh, I got to go get food stamps. I got to do this. I got to do that.'" That's a soul, guys. And you can't do it anymore. You can't depend on other things. You got to rise up in your spirit and trust that God will take care of you. The people wept that night. All the sons of Israel grumbled. See this soul stuff? grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The whole congregation said to them, "Would that we had died in the land of Egypt. We were just doing fine till you came along. Or would that we had died in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into the land to fall by the sword? He's not a good God. He's a mean God. Our wives and our little ones will become plunder. Would it not be better for us to return to Egypt?" So they said to one another, "Let us appoint a leader and return to Egypt." You got to be kidding me. There's nothing back there. It's been destroyed. God's making them face their Adamic nature. That Adamic nature is your animal instincts that will eat your dog when you get hungry. It will eat other people when you get hungry because you don't know God. God will provide for you. He will provide for his own. But those that left Egypt and went out in the wilderness and did not die in their Adamic nature, they died in the wilderness, guys. They took the trek, but they didn't make it. They refused to go up the mountain to meet God face to face in judgment, and that's why they're still souls. They are not holy, they are not righteous, and they're full of fear. See, when you're full of fear, you're not assured that your Father loves you. That's why you have to stay under that protection as a soul. This church, I'm believing with all my heart that this church, through the Melchizedek priesthood that we're developing here, is going to be able to provide. We're going to start bearing fruit. And we're going to be able to provide for you instead of the government. Because the government's coming down. If you suck on the government, you're going down with it. We're going to be able to provide here until you grow up and you take on the responsibility of taking care of other people. That's what we're growing here, guys. Go ahead. Again, let a Melchizedek priest speak. Numbers 14, 6 through 10. Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, of those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes. Remember, that's a sign of mourning. We talked about a message called Cinderella because she had cinders on her. And they spoke to all the congregation of the sons of Israel, saying, "The land which we passed through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord is pleased with us, then he will bring us into the land and give it to us. A land which flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not fear the people of the land, for they will be our prey." They're our prey. The soul says, "We're going to get eaten." A spirit says, "We're going to eat them." Their protection, look at this, guys. This is really important. Their protection, what do we talk about tonight? The Girgashite. Their protection has been removed from them. Once the Girgashite protection is removed, you go in and destroy that stronghold. Because you're a spirit now, and you can bring it down. And the Lord is with us. Their protection has been removed from them, and the Lord is with us. The Lord is with us is the Melchizedek blessing. You are a royal priesthood, a king and a priest, able to bear fruit. Do not fear them. Do not fear them. But all the congregation, that's souls, that's that sea of souls that dies, said to stone them with stones. Then the glory of the Lord appeared in the tent of meeting to all the sons of Israel. So like I said, their protection has been removed from them. Go ahead, Tim. Numbers 14, 33, 35. Surely you shall not come into the land in which I swore to settle you. So now, because they wouldn't receive Joshua and Caleb's true witness, God says, okay, you're not going to come in the land which I swore to settle you. But Joshua and Caleb, they're going to go in. Your children, however, remember they said that your children will become a prey? He says, I'm going to take your children and I'm going to bring them in. And they will know the land which you have rejected. Look what souls do. God gave them the land that flows with milk and honey. It's a good land. And they rejected it. That's what souls do. But as for you, your corpses will fall in this wilderness. Have you ever seen so many sick people and, you know, cancer and, you know, withering away? That's the Girgashite curse. And it's come full force. Your sons shall be shepherds for 40 years in the wilderness. They're going to learn to be pastors. And they will suffer, see this, for your unfaithfulness. This is the Joshua generation, and we have to suffer for the Moses generation, the law. The church, we have to suffer for that. So we've been wandering around in the wilderness for 40 years, not knowing what we're doing. Purposelessness, obscurity. Get saved and wait for Jesus to come and get us. I'm not on any kind of journey here by sitting and waiting for Jesus to come and get me. And so it's like hidden because of the Girgashite. But the sons, they're talked to by God. And they're told, oh no, you're going to go in and possess. Don't you believe in this rapture? That's why the sons go, I don't hear that. That's not what I'm hearing. And you start to leave the church. And that's when God can start providing for you. But he says that they will suffer for your unfaithfulness. The Joshua generation suffers for the Moses' generation of unfaithfulness. Until your corpses lie in the wilderness. Joshua and Caleb cannot go in the promised land until all of the Moses generation is dead. And I'm telling you right now, guys, beginning December 21st, we've gone up a level of difficulty. That's why it's hard to find a job, because New Agers, they say this. They say, nature finds a way of deciding who goes on to the next cycle. No, the spirit, either evil or good, goes on to the next cycle. The soul drowns and does not go on. You won't find a job. You'll just die. You'll just wither away in the wilderness. You'll be just like the Girgashites, the Moses generation. Because the only ones that are going forward are the Joshua generation. Okay? But it says, until your corpses lie in the wilderness. It was two more years after the children of Israel that left Egypt in Moses' generation and that they died. It was two more years before they went into the promised land. See, it's all type and shadow. So, according to the number of days which you spied out the land, 40 days, for every day you shall bear your guilt a year, even 40 years, and you will know my opposition. My opposition, this is God talking to them. You will know my opposition. I, the Lord, have spoken. Surely I will do this to all the evil congregation who are gathered together against Joshua and Caleb and Moses. No, against me. In this wilderness, they shall be destroyed, and there they will die. Go ahead. So a strong man, Psalm 19, 4 through 5, in them the heavens, the sun, the moon, the stars, he has placed a tent for the sun. A tent, any kind of covering, that's the Girgashite. But it's a good thing. I mean, you know, the sun comes out of the darkness. Which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, it rejoices as a strong man to run its course. Strong man, the word is gabor, and it means a warrior, a valiant, giant man, powerful, mighty one. So the sun is a type and shadow of a gabor, a strong man. Isaiah 1:31, the strong man will become tender, his work also a spark. Thus they shall burn both together, and there will be none to quench them. The word tender is neorith, and it means something shaken out, which is the Girgashite. God is shaking the foundations right now. That's the Girgashite. He's shaking it. And if you're not built on solid ground, you ain't going to make it, guys. As the refuge of flax. Go ahead. One more time. So this is the battle for authority, guys. Matthew 12:22-24. Then a demon-possessed man who was blind and mute was brought to Jesus, and he healed him. So the mute man spoke and saw. All the crowds were amazed and were saying, "This man cannot be the son of David, can he?" They were starting to see his invisible authority. But when the Pharisees heard that, they said, "This fella, not man," they called him a fella. They didn't say this man. They said, "This fella cast out demons only by Beelzebub, the ruler of demons." They're jealous. And that's what's going to happen with the church. The sons come out of the church, and the Girgashite shell has to let go, because when that seed goes in the ground, the Girgashite shell is no more. It decays. They didn't like him coming and taking the authority and the mind control off of the people that they had a good thing going, and he exposed them. The word, and it says that he healed them. And the word healed is therapeuo, and it means relieved him of sin. I've got a whole lot more, and maybe I'll finish it Monday. Okay, so I want to show you the authority that we're going to be given, because I can't get to it tonight. There's so much more to it. But the authority that we're given is that we have the ability to heal people because we can forgive them of their sins. Son of man can do that. A spirit, son of spirit, is son of man, can forgive people of their sins and heal them. That's how we're going to do it. So Jesus healed them, healed the demon-possessed man, and the word is therapeuo, and it means relieved him of his sin. Matthew 12:25-29, and knowing their thoughts, Jesus said to them, "Any kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and any city or house divided against itself will not stand." See, the sons come to redeem the lost. So why would we go in? We're not going in to destroy the church and all the people and just get out of here. No, we're going in to strike and get the people out and save them and rescue them from the drowning evil spirits that are going to be destroyed. So we're not going in to destroy the city. Do understand me when I say that. Any kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and any city or house divided against itself will not stand. So that's the difference between the devil. The devil, everybody's all jealous in his kingdom, and they work against each other. But God has a body that works as one, and we have a purpose. And that purpose is to get the people out so that he can have them taught to be sons. If Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? Now, use that word kingdom for city. If he is divided against himself, that city cannot stand. That stronghold. See, there are strongholds. That's what those are. Those seven strongholds, those seven evil spirits. They've made a place in you and they don't want to move. But you go in there and you start driving them out and you break those strongholds off of you. So see, the devil doesn't come in and break the strongholds off of you, does he? Jesus does, right? Okay, that's what he's saying. So stand, because Jesus, it used the word stand, the kingdom, the city will not stand. And the reason why he used the word stand is because the sons come to shake the foundation, and you're not going to be able to stand if you're not on solid foundation. If I by Beelzebub cast out demons, by whom do your sons cast them out? For this reason, they will be your judges. The sons of the Pharisees and Sadducees are casting out demons. So they're going to be your judges. That word judges is krino, and it means to condemn, to punish, to try, to sentence. And remember I told you there's two brides. One has made herself ready, and one has to be made ready. And the one that has to be made ready is going to go through tribulation without the protection. Remember? So the first bride is going to judge the church. the one that's made herself ready because she's gone in there and gotten clean, will judge the church. But if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. It's proof. See, the church is laying hands on people and healing them. But the problem is they're going and cutting off the leaves. So they say, oh, you're healed because the symptoms are gone. But the spirit is still there. And you don't have the authority to forgive somebody of their sins because you're not a son of man. So the real sons of man are going to come in and they're going to be driving out the demons and they're going to be jealous of it. Because we ain't going to just cut off the tops of the leaves. We're going to pull those suckers out. When you die, because see, you don't have any authority until you die. When your soul dies, then you are led by the Spirit of God and given the authority of the Father, and you are no longer under the law, the Girgashite. So your authority can grow. Remember how Jesus said? Everywhere he went, he said, I do what the Father tells me to do. I do what the church tells me to do. I do what the Pharisees and Sadducees and the law and all that. No, I do what the Father tells me to do. So if somebody comes and tells me to do something and my Father is telling me to do something else, if I obey you, I have fear of man. And I disobeyed my Father. And the Father, remember I told you last week, Jesus said, if you're going to follow me, you have to deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me. And where he's going to lead you is to your death, but where he's also going to lead you is straight into conflict. So if you're not ready for conflict, you better get ready. Because if you don't want to have conflict, you're going to be under a soul for the rest of your life. You're going to be a slave. That's what it means. So do you want to fight for your freedom? Or do you want to be a slave for the rest of your life? If you don't break through your soul, your eternal life will be spent in heaven on earth being a slave. I can prove you that in the Bible. There are those that will see the kingdom of God. And there are those that will enter the kingdom of God. And there are those that will have perpetual shame forever. Jeremiah 23. That's eternal life. And that perpetual shame is because you could have done it. You were safe from hell. You don't go and burn forever in eternal, because the hell is for the devil and his demons. That's what it was created for. You don't burn in hell. But you don't overcome your soul. You're a slave for the rest of your life. I can't have that, guys. And that's why I battled this. And now I have the authority to set others free. And this is the call. You're going to have to get ready for the conflict. Because we can't just hold hands anymore. And just get along. The righteous has to come. And call the unrighteous out. You have to say what you're doing is wrong. And they're not going to like it. But God's kingdom cannot come until you do. Because God's kingdom grows like a mustard seed. And that mustard seed is holy and powerful and mighty and true. And it's tiny. But that mustard seed will destroy all of those churches. It has that ability. And that's why the call right now, God's showing me, is for you to come to him and say, Lord, I want you to be my comforter. I want you to be my provider. I want you to protect me. I want you to clothe me. I'm scared. But I do want that. I do want it. I don't have it. I don't want to rely on the government. I don't want to rely on anybody else because, Lord, they won't be there. They don't have that ability to take care of me. Only you do. And I'm willing to go out in the wilderness with you and learn how. It's a heavy call, guys. I'm going to tell you. I just emerged from it. It is tough. It says Jesus was hungry. And you're going to have to be hungry. And you're going to have to face the devil out in the wilderness. But when you face that devil and when you overcome him, you've got the authority to tear down all of his strongholds. So the rest of the message I'll finish on Monday, because our authority has got to grow, guys, or we're going to be swallowed by the sea of souls. Your life is absolutely insignificant unless you grow as a spirit. So Father, can you give me some soft music? I thank you for this message, Lord. I thank you that you show me step by step where we are on the time zone with you, Lord. Father, I know we have souls in our church. I know we have people that have not overcome the seven heads of the dragon. I know we still have people that lean on other people to take care of them. And Lord, I ask you this night, give the ability, to the leadership of this church to provide for these souls that are growing. Give us the wisdom, Lord, not to take your place, but to bring them to you, Lord. Not to let them lean on us, but to teach them how to lean on you until they're able to bear fruit themselves. Oh, that's heavy. Grow the leadership of this church, Lord. Father, I pray your consuming fire would come over the leadership of this church and that we would be able to tear down the strongholds, Lord. When we tear down the strongholds, that's when we start spoiling them and bringing all the wealth where it rightfully belongs into your church to take care of the people on a foundation of righteousness. Oh, Father, I pray that our leadership in this church would be holy and perfect and pure, righteous, able to say, devil, you got nothing in me. And then, Father, let us bear fruit. We're taking the Girgashite shell off of the church and off of the world. That means that there's not going to be any provision. There's going to be chaos, absolute chaos. But it's going to drive them to come and taste the pure water at Artesian Well. Oh, Father. I thank you for this church. I thank you that this salon that we're in right now has died. This is so sure foundation, people, that we're here. I'm telling you. The anointing is so strong here. I wouldn't want to be anywhere else. This salon died actually about 6 years ago. And it is resurrecting right now. And I'm telling you, when the enemy comes, he's not going to be able to tear down this foundation. Because he cannot defeat someone and something that has died and resurrected. It has resurrection power in it. But one thing that we've got to always keep in mind, just like Ephesus, Ephesus was just like this church. It was an apostolic church. It had a strong, righteous foundation. They were able to judge. They could recognize the synagogue of Satan and the Nicolaitans and the church and all those people that claimed to be Jews and they were not. But they lost their first love. And what that means is in this group, Lord, there are people that are going to receive this message and they're not going to let it change their hearts. And they're going to get puffed up and they're going to become an enemy. And we've got to be like an ox and get under them and serve them and fight their demons so that they can see that they're headed for destruction. They think they're going the right way, but the mouth of the lion is open and he's just waiting for them to walk into it, and they can't see. And we have got to cry out to God for them to come back. We've got to judge. We've got to tell them that what they're doing is wrong. But we got to cry out to God for them to come back. We can't just go, well, you just go ahead if you want to go. Because then you lose your first love. Jesus said in John 17 to his Father, his last prayer on earth, he said, I haven't lost any that you gave me, except for the son of perdition, which was, he fulfilled the scriptures. There will be a son of perdition that will come in our midst. And they will be the enemy. I'm telling you, we are fulfilling prophecy. It will be exactly like it is in the Bible. So the leadership of this church better get ready. The leadership of this church better understand what it means to not lose your first love. You've got to lay your life down for everybody and fight for them. No matter what they say against this leadership, no matter what they do against this leadership, we got to bring them back. This church is going to grow from this point, I can promise you. And I know we've enjoyed this small little mustard seed type of setting, but it is going to get bigger. And when it gets bigger, that's when we got to be careful, guys. I pray, Father, that you would speak to their hearts right now. If there's anybody here tonight that is struggling with those seven heads of the dragon, I pray that they would come forward and we would pray for them. They just can't seem to get free. I pray you would move on their hearts, Lord. We want to be sons. We want to be full grown, Lord. Able to take the land. Willing to stand before your face. To become holy and righteous. And perfect in your eyes. In Jesus' name. As I stand here in your presence, of your beauty I will always stand in awe. I reach my hands out to the heavens, yeah.